Morning, everyone. Here we are again back for our third Lent Sunday service. Welcome, everybody. I hope everybody's good and looking forward to being able to get out and about a little bit more very soon. It won't be long now, will it? Just a couple of things to say before we move into our first prayer and songs. So just to let you know that next Sunday, in case you hadn't realised, is Mothering Sunday. So we will be here at 8 o'clock for communion next Sunday, which we're looking forward to in person. And we've got a lovely team of volunteers who are going to prepare some posies for Mothering Sunday. So if you're not here at 8 o'clock, we will make some posies available outside church for people to take as a gift and a reminder of the love of God and the love of Mother Church. So please come along if you would like to and help yourself to a little posy for you, for someone who's been like a mum to you. If you're a mum and if you've got relationships that suggest a nurturing, caring, loving mum role, please help yourself. And just a rather quiet little notice, I guess, that we will be serving coffee outside church this afternoon. We're not publicising it hugely, and we don't want too many crowds gathering, but please come along. It's really to serve the passers-by as they walk through our churchyard and just offer an act of hospitality, really. So you're very welcome, of course, to come along and join us for a hot drink this afternoon. After our first gathering prayer, we're going to have again one of our favourite songs, which seems to be appropriate for so many themes and circumstances, doesn't it? I think you'll guess which one I mean, but we will be singing it soon. And then I'll say some more about what's going to happen. So let me read and let me say our opening gathering prayer now. God, you rejoice with those who rejoice. You mourn with those who mourn, and you call us to do the same. Help us to come to you today with honesty and openness, sharing our sorrows and knowing your comfort. In the name of Jesus, amen.
In my wrestling, in my doubts, in my failures, you won't walk out. Your great love will lead me through. You are the peace in my troubled sea. Oh, you are the peace in my troubled sea. In the silence you won't let go. In the questions your truth will hold. Your great love will lead.
So the theme of our journey through the wilderness, worship in the wilderness this week, is that it is a sorrowful journey at times. It's quite a difficult topic and difficult theme to focus on, I know. But it's true, isn't it? Life sometimes has its sorrows, and Jesus certainly knew sorrow. So I found myself outside Aldi this week, asking a few people what makes them sad. And here are some of their responses.
Well, so many things make us sad at the moment, aren't there? The homeless people on the streets and the, starving and the state of the world, really. It's just, we just want to get over this pandemic now and get back to some sort of normality, really. I think that's all I can say on that. It's off the cuff, it's difficult. Is that enough?
Okay, what makes me feel sad is how people don't treat each other equally and with respect. And I think that's really important nowadays in the community to do that. Okay.
The thing that makes me the saddest is that I haven't seen my son, been able to give him a hug, and that he lives in a very rural place and he hasn't got any family or friends around him, and he works from home, and I can see that he's going downhill a little bit because his girlfriend works in Juba, doing a great job with a charity out there with Sudanese, that's how I feel the most sad, just not being able to give him a hug, not seeing him at Christmas. And other than that, I feel really happy because I've got a double allotment and I can stay on it away from everybody. So,
when I can do something I want to, and when I'm not allowed to do something I really want to do, or we can go somewhere, or when someone annoys me or calls me names, that makes me angry and sad, and that's all.
At this time, because I've not seen my two new granddaughters, and I'd love to see them and see what they're like and what they're doing already. And it's sad because my next door neighbour's just had a major fall and broken a hip, and that's quite upsetting too. And all the deaths that you hear from this horrible coronavirus is terrible, and I just wish it'd be all over very, very soon.
How long, Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? We pray for those who feel forgotten and unseen. May they know that they are remembered and seen by you, God. Help us to partner with you to remember the forgotten. Search our hearts to reveal those we hide our faces from, the outcast, the stranger, or the homeless. Change our hearts that we may turn our faces towards these people and see them as your beloved children. How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and day after day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? We pray for those we know who struggle with mental illness, anxiety, and depression. We pray that there will be resources released to help, enough staff employed and finances given towards mental health services nationally. Help us to be a friend and a listening ear to those who suffer. Fill us with compassion and wisdom. Ultimately, we pray for those who wrestle with sorrow, that they may know your victory over those dark thoughts which currently seem to triumph. Look on me and answer, Lord my God. Give light to my eyes, or I will sleep in death. And my enemy will say, I have overcome him. And my foes will rejoice when I fall. We also pray for those things that make us sad. The homeless starving, people not being treated equally and with respect, not being able to meet up with family or to hug, not seeing our grandchildren, when others are unkind by word or deed, our neighbours who are vulnerable, the deaths from COVID, and your creation, Lord, which we are constantly aware of, locally, nationally, and internationally, being decimated for human greed. We pray for those who might be considered fallen by those around them. May they know your restoration and grace. Help us to not judge or exclude your beloved children, but instead lift them up in prayer and embrace them with the grace we know in Christ. Thank you, loving Father, for hearing our prayer. We exclaim together. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing the Lord's praise, for he has been good to me.
It's my shepherd, I'll not want. He makes me lie in pastures green. He leads me by the still waters. His goodness restores my soul, and I will trust in you alone, and I will trust in you alone. For your endless mercy follows me, your goodness will lead me home. He guides my ways in righteousness, and he anoints my head with oil, and my cup it overflows with joy. your endless mercy follows me. Your goodness will lead me home. And though I walk the darkest path, I will not fear the evil one, for you are with me and your rod and staff are the comfort I need to know. And I will trust in you alone. And I will trust in you.
This reading is from Exodus chapter 3. Now Moses was tending the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the back of the desert and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire from the midst of a bush. So he looked, and behold, the bush was burning with fire, but the bush was not consumed. Then Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush does not burn. So when the Lord saw that he turned aside to look, God called him from the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here I am. Then he said, Do not draw near this place. Take your sandals off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the oppression of my people who are in Egypt, and have heard their cry because of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. Now, therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel has come to me, and I have also seen the oppression with which the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore, and I will send you to Pharaoh that you may bring my people out of Egypt. This is the word of the Lord.
The reading is from John chapter 11, verses 20 to 29 and 32 to 36. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. Lord, Martha said to Jesus, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask. Jesus said to her, your brother will rise again. Martha answered, I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day. Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live, even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this? Yes, Lord, she replied. I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is coming to the world. After she had said this, she went back and called her Mary aside. The teacher is here, she said, and is asking for you. When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." This is the word of the Lord.
Jesus wept. Jesus wept. It's one of the most beautiful verses in scripture, really. And probably one of the shortest, if not the shortest. Jesus wept. Now, this isn't the only time that we hear Jesus weep in scripture. He weeps for Jerusalem and its people as he looks out over it from the Mount of Olives, knowing what's to come. But I think nowhere do we get a picture this intimate into Jesus's feelings as this story in John's Gospel. This wasn't just some stranger who has died. This is Jesus's great dear friend Lazarus, and it hurts him. The grieving family weren't just any grieving family. They were Martha and Mary, his close friends and followers who he'd spent much time with. This is the Mary that we hear elsewhere in Jesus' story, had such a powerful encounter with him that she, as a result, she scandalously responded by wiping his feet with her tears and her hair. She loved him deeply. And now he encounters Mary in her utter grief and desolation at the loss of her brother, Lazarus. And frankly, I think her anger for him not being there. Where were you? Where were you? You could have saved him, but you didn't. You weren't here. Now he's dead. And it's your fault. These must have been really difficult words to hear, I think. And so we hear that Jesus wept with Mary. He weeps for his dead friend, Lazarus, and he weeps for his grieving, hurting friends. You know, the power of grief was brought home to me once again, just on Friday, actually. I was taking a funeral, really privileged to take a funeral for a lady. In this case, the lady had 14 grandchildren. And because now it's possible, as of this week, to have 30 people at a funeral service at the crematorium rather than 15, it meant that all of them were able to be there. Whereas for the last year or so, that wouldn't have been possible. And because not all of them could have been there, none of them would have been there. But this time, they were all there, a whole grieving family together in one place. And I was just really powerfully struck once again by the raw physical impact of grief and loss. You know, like an assault, like a physical assault. And it's tough to see. It really is tough to see. So if you're grieving right now, if you're hurting right now, if you're battered by the pain of loss and grief, if you're angry with God as a result and wonder why he wasn't there, I think the first thing I want to say this morning from this reading is that Jesus is with you in the grief and the pain. Just like he was with Mary and Martha, Jesus comes alongside and he weeps with us. He feels each death and loss as keenly. Each of his precious children whom he knew and he loved and he created and he foreknew before the beginning of time, as it were, he weeps for them alongside us in our pain. And life at times is a sorrowful journey, isn't it? Now, of course, it is also at times a joy-filled laughter-filled, blessed journey. You know, we know that these different seasons happen in life. But there are times, aren't there, in life when we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. But why? Why does God let it be this way? It's the great and understandable question thrown at us so often, isn't it? If God loves us, why does he allow suffering? Why did he take the one that I love and let me suffer all this pain? Oh, wow. Well, I put simply, I think this pain is the price of love. It's the other side of love. You know, we could only avoid sorrow if we were happy to avoid love. I guess we could theoretically have a world without suffering and grief and loss. But it would be a world without love, at least this side of the resurrection. And who wants that? Who wants that? Who wants a world without love in order that we might avoid pain? And that's certainly not God's way of dealing with pain. You know, if grief is the price of love, then how much must Jesus grieve over each of us? If his love for us is as boundless and outrageous as he says it is, and it is, how much more must he grieve for us? Now, I suspect that you're not all fans of the Marvel comic universe, which has spawned so many successful films over the last few years. You might know them through like titles like the Avengers series or Captain America or Spider-Man or Guardians of the Galaxy. But if you're not, please bear with me just for a minute, even if you've never watched anything from Marvel. Because over the last couple of weeks, April and I have been watching one of the spin-off series, TV series, from the Marvel series of films. And it's called WandaVision. I heartily recommend it. It's called WandaVision and it features two of the characters from the Marvel films, Wanda and Vision. And essentially, the whole series is a reflection on grief and on loss. Now, before the series begins, we sort of already know from the films that Vision, who's one of the characters, he dies having found love with Wanda. And the whole series really enters into Wanda's loss, sort of almost boundless, measureless loss and grief, and her way of coping, or frankly not coping, with that loss and grief. Now, and I won't spoil the series for you, but there is this one really beautiful scene in it, which is a flashback to Wanda and Vision when they first knew each other, when they were first connecting together. And as Wanda, she's reflecting on the pain of the loss of her parents, actually, and her brother, and the pain that she really continues to experience. Vision comes alongside her in her pain, and he offers this this question. He says, "What is grief if not love persevering? What is grief if not love persevering?" And that's so true, isn't it? So true. We grieve because we love, and we don't stop loving just because someone we love dies. We carry the loss and the pain with us, and we carry the love with us. And it can resurface years and years later, the pain and the loss, because we continue to carry the love with us. Love never gives up. Love never gives up on us. Jesus never gives up on us. God is love. He weeps with us and he joins in his love persevering through the death and the loss. But of course, this is not the end of the story. And this is really important, isn't it? You know, what we heard today is not all that needs to be said. Jesus doesn't just join in with us in our grief and come alongside us and weep alongside us. He does that, but that is not all he does. You know, it might be Lent and the reading might have deliberately stopped short of the end of the story of Lazarus, but we know the story. We know the story. Jesus does not leave Mary and Martha in the depths of pain and just sit with them in their grief. He physically raises Lazarus from the dead. In addition to knowing Jesus's presence in our pain and loss and suffering, we know the great Christian hope of Jesus being the one who raises us from what feels like dead and hopeless positions. This is what God does. He brings people from the dead. He literally raises Lazarus from the most hopeless situation imaginable, death. And in a preview, if you like, a bit of a taster of what's to come in the resurrection. You know, this is at the very heart of our faith and our hope, isn't it? You know, as Paul said to the church in Corinth in one of his letters, in his first letter to the Corinthians, and this is a little bit of a paraphrase. Paul says, if corpses can't be raised, then Christ wasn't, because he was indeed dead. And if Christ wasn't raised, then all you're doing is wandering around in the dark as lost as ever. If all we get out of Christ is a little inspiration for a few short years, we're a pretty sorry lot. But the truth is that Jesus Christ has been raised up, the first in a long legacy of those who are going to leave the cemeteries. That's a lovely image, isn't it? A long legacy of those who are going to leave the cemeteries. So, today, what is grief if not love persevering? And what's the resurrection if not God's love persevering? The love of God refusing to accept the power of death. That is our great hope. In the reality of grief and pain and loss as part of all of our human journey, in the sorrow-filled parts of our journey, Jesus comes alongside us and weeps with us and promises us the hope of the resurrected life to come. And my prayer today is really simple. My prayer today is really simple, that we too would know his loving presence in the suffering of today and the perseverance of his love in the resurrection to come. Have a blessed day. Amen.
To you, all eyes are laid open. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Today, please give us our daily bread. Forgive our sins as we forgive who sin against us. Don't get us into temptation, O evil. Deliver us from evil. The power and the glory are yours, forever and ever. Amen.
Blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong. In the Savior's love, through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy
Thank you for being with us this morning. We trust you found it helpful. It's something we do as church family is share our sorrows as well as our joys. So I hope maybe you'll feel able, if you would like to contact anyone in our church family. I know that many of us do anyway, don't we? Share our life journey between us. But do get in touch if it would be helpful. We'd love to hear from you. And now let me say our closing prayer that sends us into the rest of this week. Thank you, gracious Father, for the space to be honest with you today. To you, all hearts are open. From you, no secrets are hidden. So may we continue to talk openly with you as we go from this place. Make us a people who listen to others, sharing their sorrows and spreading and sharing your comfort in the power of your Spirit. Amen. Let's say the grace together. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. May peace be with you.
may fail, and there I find you in the mystery, in oceans deep, my faith will stand, and I'll call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours. You